Here we have a function f of x. To the left of 1, let's put a point on the function, x. Now, what happens as we slide x closer and closer to 1 without actually reaching it? As x approaches 1, notice that the function value of x approaches 2. Now, what about from the right? As x approaches 1 from the right, f of x approaches 2 as well. So we see that from both the left and the right, as the x value gets infinitely closer and closer to 1 from either side, f of x seems to approach 2. This is called a limit. A limit is the value a function gets closer to as the input approaches a certain number. In our example, we would say that the limit of our function, f of x, as x approaches 1, is 2. To notate a limit, first we write lim for limit, and under this we put the x point and an arrow pointing towards the value it's approaching. To the right of this, we put our function. If you see a limit whose target value has a plus or minus sign, this does not mean positive or negative. This means we are finding a one-sided limit. As the name implies, a one-sided limit is taken from only the left or the right. A minus sign tells us to find the limit from the left, and a plus sign is the limit from the right. For a limit to exist, the one-sided limits must exist and be equal. Let's see what this means. In this example, does the limit of f of x as x approaches 3 exist? Well, let's first take the limit from the left. As x approaches 3 from the left, the function seems to approach 6, so that's the one-sided limit from the left. On the other hand, taking the limit from the right, the function seems to approach 0, so both one-sided limits exist but are not the same. Therefore, the overall limit of f of x as x approaches 3 cannot exist. Here's another example. Does the limit of f of x as x approaches 2 exist? Well, taking the one-sided limits, as x approaches 2 from the left, f of x approaches 4. From the right, f of x also approaches 4. The one-sided limits are the same. So this means the limit of f of x as x approaches 2 is 4. Notice that although f of 2 is undefined, the limit still exists. As long as the one-sided limits exist, we're fine. Now, let's move over to negative 2. What is the limit of f of x as x approaches negative 2? Well, taking the limit from the left, as x approaches negative 2, f of x seems to approach negative 1. From the right, as x approaches negative 2, f of x approaches 2. The one-sided limits do not agree, thus the limit does not exist. For a limit to exist, the one-sided limits must exist and be the same. So far, all the limits we've evaluated were on graphs, so let's try finding some limits using tables. Using the data from this table, can we find the limit of f of x as x approaches 4? Well, let's first sketch the points. Using the values smaller than 4, or to the left of 4, what value does f of x seem to approach? Well, as the distance between the x point and 4 gets smaller and smaller, the function seems to approach 1. So from the data, we can conclude that the limit of f of x as x approaches 4 from the left is 1. Notice a few things here. First, notice that the distance between the x point and 4 gets a lot smaller the closer x gets to 4. This is important in a limit, since the idea behind a limit is to get infinitely close to an x value while not reaching it. Without this detail, we would not be able to estimate the one-sided limit. Also, notice that it is possible that somewhere between 3.999 and 4, there's a massive spike or something unexpected. So the limit might be something else. But from what we can see on the table, 1 is a really good estimate for a one-sided limit. And lastly, notice that although the function value does exist, the limit is not 3. Remember, the limit is not dependent on the value of the function. We'll touch on this some more later in the video. So we found that the limit of f of x as x approaches 4 from the left is 1. What about from the right? Well, plotting the points given on the right, or the numbers greater than 4, we see that as the distance between 4 and the x value gets smaller and smaller, f of x is getting closer and closer to 1. So we can conclude that the limit from the right is 1 as well. And look at that, the two one-sided limits exist and are equal, so we know that the limit of f of x as x approaches 4 is 1. Okay, here's another table. If we were told to find the limit of g of x as x approaches 2, can we conclude that it is 4? Well, no. If we plot the points, we see that the gaps are too large. In order for the limit to be 4, we need something like this. But this graph isn't guaranteed. There might be something crazy going on in the middle. The table just doesn't have enough information. So to use a table to evaluate a limit, the x values must get closer and closer to the target value, and both limits must be the same. If the gaps are too large, there just isn't enough data to provide a reasonable conclusion. Now, if the limit of a function as x approaches a constant is the same as its function value at that point for all x values of its domain, we say that the function is continuous. This may seem like a mouthful, so let's visualize this. Is this function continuous? Well, if we pick a random x value, we see that the limit is the function value at that point. A simple way to determine the continuity of a function, or whether or not it is continuous, is to trace it. If you can draw the function without lifting up your pencil, you have a continuous function. Now, why is continuity useful? Let's say we were told to find the limit of f of x as x approaches 3. Well, since we know the function is continuous, we know that the limit must be the function value at 3, or f of 3. Now, a function is not continuous if there are jumps, holds, or gaps. These are called discontinuities. Functions with discontinuities cannot be traced in one stroke of a pen. There are four kinds of discontinuities. Endpoint discontinuities, where there is a large undefined interval. Removable discontinuities, where a point is removed. Jump discontinuities, where the function jumps and there's a vertical gap. And an infinite discontinuity, which is also called an asymptote. Now, just as a quick terminology note, if a limit increases or decreases without bound as x approaches a certain value, you may see it notated like this. But this does not mean it equals infinity. Rather, this means the limit is unbounded and approaches infinity. In such cases, the limit technically does not exist, as infinity is not a real number. Now, let's find the limits of the product of functions. First, let's find the limit from the left. To find the limit of a product of functions, we can just find the limits separately and then multiply at the end. So the limit of f of x as x approaches 0 from the left is 1. The limit of h of x as x approaches 0 from the left is 4. The product of 1 and 4 is 4. So the limit of f of x times h of x from the left is 4. Now from the right, the limit of f of x as x approaches 0 is 1. The limit as h of x approaches 0 from the right is 4. The product is 4 again. Since the one-sided limits match, the limit of f of x times h of x as x approaches 0 is 4. Let's look at another example. What is the limit of f of x times h of x as x approaches 1? First, let's find the limit from the left. The limit of f of x as x approaches 1 from the left is 0. The limit of h of x as x approaches 1 is 4. 0 times 4 is 0. So the limit from the left is 0. Now on the right. The limit of f of x as x approaches 1 from the right is 0. And the limit of h of x as x approaches 1 from the right is also 0. So the limit of f of x times h of x from the right is 0 times 0, or 0. Both of our one-sided limits are 0, so the limit of f of x times h of x as x approaches 1 is 0. So that's the limit of the product of functions. The limit of the quotient of functions is very similar. Just like the product of functions, we first need to take the one-sided limits of the individual functions and then piece it together. If the limits exist, so does the limit of the quotient. Well, most of the time. There is one caveat. What value can the limit of the denominator not be? 0. If the bottom is 0, then sometimes we'll get an undefined limit, so we'll have to keep an eye out for that. Alright, now let's see the limit of the quotient of functions at work. What is the limit as x approaches 0 of f of x over g of x? First, we know that we must take the one-sided limits. Starting from the left, the limit of f of x as x approaches 0 is 1. The limit of g of x from the left is also 1. So the limit of f of x over g of x from the left is 1 over 1, or 1. So far, so good. Now, what are the limits from the right? Well, the limit of f of x as x approaches 0 from the right is 3. The limit of g of x from the right is also 3. Once again, 3 over 3 is 1. The one-sided limits of f of x over g of x are both 1, so 1 is the overall limit. Here's another example. Does this limit exist? Well, let's check. As g of x approaches 1 from the left, we see that it approaches 1. But the limit of h of x from the left is 0. 1 over 0 is undefined. So that means either this limit doesn't exist, or it's unbounded and approaches infinity. Now, when substituting, if we got something like 0 over 0, then that could also mean that the limit still exists. We'll touch on this later in the video. Now, let's look at the limits of composite functions. To calculate the limit of a composite function like f of g of x, First, we need to evaluate the limit of the inner function as it approaches the given value. And then, we need to find the value of the outer function at the value of the limit. However, for this to be the case, two things must be true. First, the limit of the inner function must exist. And second, the outer function must be continuous near the value of the limit. Let's try evaluating some limits of composite functions. What is the limit of f of h of x as x approaches 2? The first thing we need to do is find the limit of h of x as x approaches 2. Does this limit exist? Well, the limit of h of x as x approaches 2 from the left is 3. As x approaches 2 from the right, the limit of h of x is also 3. The two one-sided limits are the same, so the limit of h of x as x approaches 2 is 3. It exists. So, now we need to check. Is f of x continuous around 3? Well, using our pencil tracing technique, we see that we can draw f of x without lifting up our pencil, so it is continuous. Since the limit of the inner function exists and the outer function is continuous, we know that the limit of the composite function is the outer function's value at the limit of the inner function. F of 3 is 2. So the limit of f of h of x as x approaches 2 is 2. Okay, now let's evaluate limits without a graph or table. When all we have is a limit, the first step is direct substitution into the function. The output will tell us about the limit. If the result of the direct substitution is a real number, then that's the limit. If it is a number over 0, then the limit either does not exist or is unbounded. And if the result is the indeterminate form 0 over 0, that tells us that we can try to manipulate the equation and hopefully find a limit. Let's see what all this means. First, let's find the limit of x plus 3 as x approaches 0. Well, directly substituting 0 into x plus 3, we get 0 plus 3, which is 3. 3 is a real number, so that's our limit. To verify our answer, let's take a look at the graph of x plus 3. As x approaches 0, we see that the function indeed approaches 3, so 3 is the limit. Here's another one. We're trying to find the limit of 1 over x minus 1 as x approaches 1. To find this, we begin by directly substituting into the function. In the denominator, we have 1 minus 1, which is 0. This leaves us with 1 over 0, so we know that either the limit doesn't exist or it's unbounded. And looking at the graph of 1 over x minus 1, we see that as x approaches 1, the limit does not exist. Alright, what is the limit of x squared minus 9 over x plus 3? Well, if we directly substitute, we get 0 over 0. So let's try some algebraic manipulation. We know that x squared minus 9 is a perfect square, so it can be factored as x plus 3 times x minus 3. If we use this, now we see that the x plus 3s in the numerator and in the denominator cancel out, leaving us with x minus 3. If we directly substitute in now, we get negative 3 minus 3, which is negative 6. Negative 6 is a real number, so that's our limit. Again, we can look at the graph to confirm our answer. Here's another example that has a radical. If we directly substitute, we get 0 over 0. So let's try to manipulate this problem. Since we have a radical, let's get rid of it by multiplying it by the conjugate. Simplifying the numerator, we get x minus 4 minus 1, which is x minus 5. So the x minus 5s can cancel out. After doing this, we get 1 over the square root of x minus 4 plus 1. And now we can directly substitute in again. This time, we get 1 over 1 plus 1, which is 1 over 2. And that's a real number, so that's the limit. Once again, we can check the graph, and we see that we are correct. Now, there are two foundational trigonometric limits that are useful to know. First, the limit as x approaches 0 of x over sine of x is 1. The second is the limit as x approaches 0 of 1 minus cosine of x over x, which equals 0. These two trigonometric limits should be remembered, as they'll help you out when you encounter harder trig problems. For example, if we had to find the limit of 1 minus cosine of x over sine of x as x approaches 0, directly substituting, we get 0 over 0. So let's try manipulating the function. If we multiply the function by x over x, we can then separate the limits into the trig limits that we looked at earlier. Now, we have a product of functions, so we can find the limits separately and then multiply at the end. The limit of 1 minus cosine of x over x as x approaches 0 is 0, and the limit of x over sine of x as x approaches 0 is 1. And now multiplying, 0 times 1 is 0, so that's the solution to this limit. And if we sketch the graph, we see that we have the right answer. Okay, that was a lot. Let's recap. A limit is the value a function gets closer to as a point gets closer and closer to a given value. A limit only exists if both one-sided limits exist and are the same. A function is continuous if the limit of any point on the function equals the function's value. This can be checked by tracing the function without lifting up the pencil. To evaluate a limit, we directly substitute. If the result is a number, that's the limit. If the result is a number over 0, the limit doesn't exist or it's unbounded. And if the limit is 0 over 0, we should try manipulating the limit until we find a solution. So that's an introduction to limits. If you enjoyed this, don't forget to like, subscribe, and share the video. Now, keep working hard and keep learning. Thank you for watching.